evening, and thank you for coming. A couple notes before I introduce tonight's speaker is, first of all, we'd like to make sure to thank the ASCC for their generous funding of the Clark Art Talks. Thanks to the Clark Art Talks Committee, which is largely composed of a bunch of art faculty, so thank you to them for developing the lineup this year. This is our second to last lecture of the year. The last lecture will be on June 10th, and it'll be Sutton Barris Kohler. So make sure to put that on your schedule for your last opportunity for one of the Clark Art Talks series. Okay, so I would like to introduce Kate Bingham-Invert, our speaker tonight. I met her for the first time a couple months ago at Liquid Agency, where she gave a talk with Josh Berger and Namita Gupta-Wiggers, who Josh Berger is the one of the founding members of Plasm magazine, and he was here and had the Plasm show a couple years ago, if you guys caught that. And Namita Gupta-Wiggers is the curator at the Museum of Contemporary Craft. I tell you, that was a really fun night. What a bunch of like great personalities all having a discussion about everything together. But I've known of Kate's work since she first came to Portland and started. She landed the head of graphic design job at Portland State University. And I've kind of followed your work since then. Most notably, Kate is known for her daily drawings, which she ended on the day we had that lecture. And I felt so, like that was actually kind of, you know, a sense of gravity that she stopped doing her daily drawings after 8 years?
8 years.
After 8 years. And she's also known for her book, Obsessive Consumption, What Did You Buy Today? By Princeton, what's it called, Princeton Review?
Princeton Architectural Press.
Thank you. I totally got that name wrong. Also, I love her journals, What Did You Eat Today and What Did You Buy Today? You can buy those as journals. She also sells some posters. So basically a lot of various products that have to do with her illustration, which you're going to become familiar with tonight in her talk, I'm sure. In addition to her job as the head of graphic design, she also has her own design business. Design and illustration with clients such wide range of clients from Chipotle to Little Big Burger, Hallmark Cards, Google, Girl Scouts of America, The New York Times, The Gap, and Sasquatch Books, just to name a few. She has also does a lot of interviews and lectures. She gives talks, and including a recent appearance at TEDx Portland. Congratulations.
Thanks.
On that. Communication Arts, the big publication for graphic design, and Print Magazine. Those are both the top magazines in graphic design, biggest names. And of course, the local Creative Mornings that is here in Portland. You were one of the founding members of Creative Mornings. So please help me in welcoming Kate Bingham-Invert.
Thank you guys so much. And also, it's really nice outside. Really nice. So thank you for spending the next 48 minutes with me in kind of a dark room as you listen to me talk about my work, okay? So, hi, Clark College. My name's Kate Bingham-Invert, and I am a teacher, illustrator, and maker of things. So I'm an assistant professor. Actually, I just got tenure, so I'm an associate professor of graphic design at Portland State University. And the majority of my week is spent with hardworking and talented students like these guys. It's a pretty special place. My nights and weekends are spent with lots of pens and lots of paper and lots of email, working with a variety of pretty great people. My client work mostly consists of editorial illustration, illustration for animations, and apparel and surface design. I'm just going to quickly go through some of my recent projects before I dive into the meat of my topic tonight. But just a few days ago, I had some illustrations for Chipotle for their new Cultivating Thought Authors campaign that just was released a few days ago. So Chipotle teamed up different illustrators with writers such as Toni Morrison, George Saunders, Sarah Silverman, and in my case, I got to illustrate Judd Apatow's words, which is pretty exciting because I'm a huge Freaks and Geeks fan, and so I did completely geek out that I got to draw a bunch of his good, funny stories for bags that you put your burritos in. So Chipotle. I also was the illustrator for the Car to Go campaign that was released a few months ago as well. And we worked with actual Car to Go members and helped tell their Car to Go experiences. And I also think it helped that I'm an actual Car to Go member. And I also think that might have been a paid endorsement because I really like Car to Go, and we worked on this for several months, and it was pretty fun. And during the school year, I work with a lot of magazines and provide quick turnaround editorial illustrations. This was from a recent Real Simple magazine, and then these are some recent cards for Hallmark. Sometimes for Hallmark, I get to develop my own card ideas, and then sometimes I have to develop what the writers have written. And so, for example, like the one that's up at the top corner that has the truck with the hearts coming out of the exhaust that says sending a little love your way today, I didn't write that one. it was just a brief that's like, we really need you to draw a truck that has hearts coming out. I'm like, okay. But then like for instance, that vintage retro old school one, that's actually a daily purchase drawing of mine that was being able to use as a card on Hallmark. And then This World Has Both You and Brunch, that's based off of my obsessions with brunch. And then the one that has all the Facebook likes that says, I want to give you a million thumbs up. That's me too. But I didn't write that having a fun birthday is 90% mental and 10% alcohol, although sometimes I do agree with that. So anyway, another component of my freelance life is also invading spaces, different corporate spaces, and creating installations like the one I recently did for the Etsy headquarters in Brooklyn. I love getting into a space and just kind of making it my own, and you'll see more of that later in my talk too. But when I'm not teaching or illustrating for clients, I'm working on lots of projects that revolve around the topic of consumption. And actually, the consumption projects, they started before any of my freelance work did. The consumption projects actually gave birth to all of my illustration and freelance work and actually teaching too. And so it's kind of strange. My life, I feel like, exists in three parts, which is teaching, that's a huge part of it, illustration, another really big part of it, and then research. And the magic spot is when all of them blend together, okay? Again, I couldn't do one of these without the other. It's all connected for me, and those connections are the best, they really are. And so I'm excited to talk with you about all three today. So a bit of a background about my consumption projects, these projects that I do out of love and extreme interest. For about the last 12 years, I've been making objects and developing projects that talk about our wants and needs and how we use and engage with our stuff, okay? Along with obsessing over the things that we buy or give or steal, like that's actually a drawing of some of the most popular items that people shoplift. Okay, so we've got preparation H, meat, we've got Aleve, batteries, luxury goods, and Red Bull. So that's just a nice portrait. I also make work about personal consumption, celebration, joy, privacy, guilt, lots of guilt. Guilt's a huge theme in my work, and the everyday. I also talk a lot about excess, okay? And the community of all of these shared experiences. So I share a studio with these four stellar humans, Clifton Burt, Jason Sturgill, Tina Snow Lee, and Will Bryant. Clifton's actually my husband, and Will is one of my former students from Mississippi State about 10 years ago, who has now quite a really amazing illustration career of his own. And we work on projects independently and together. And these are some shots of our studio space, which just is, when they're all together, it kind of gives me a little bit of like overload. Things are all over our walls. It's kind of insane. But another thing that the five of us have in common is that we're also all teachers. So we all either teach at Portland State, my husband teaches at PNCA. We're all teachers, we're all designers and illustrators too. We don't necessarily work on projects together, but we like working on projects next together. Does that make sense, next to each other? Okay. So I'm gonna shift a little bit to the heart of this talk. And again, like I said earlier, I'm a professor in the graphic design program at Portland State University. And our program is heavily focused on research and multiple iterations and critique after critique after critique. And it's a huge part of their process, okay? We spend hours developing elaborate project briefs, lots of mood boards and strategies to help execute their ideas. And so this has created an army of rabid image collectors, which is great. Images are great. But sometimes this has us feeling like we're drowning in images. And we can spend sometimes all day looking at cool stuff. And what was supposed to feel inspiring kind of ends up feeling disgusting. Like you get internet overload, you know what I'm talking about? You're just clicking through like, well, that person's making cool stuff. That person's making cool stuff. That's good. I hate everything I've ever done, ever. You know, you just kind of get into that spiral. And again, like we live in this world right now where it's so easy to like things and to not really think that deeply about the things that we're liking. I love liking things, don't get me wrong. So I see my students and myself getting completely overwhelmed by choice, right? And I saw my students and myself getting completely overwhelmed by options. And then I saw my students and myself feeling bad about the work that they were making and constantly comparing it to the pile of design work that they were looking at online. So I wanted to make an exercise where they had to pause and then take a small lesson from our curator friends, our very smart curator friends. So what our very smart curator friends do is interpret, okay? They draw through lines between different things and images and create new meanings. And again, you must intensely study visual culture, I feel, to be, you know, in that culture. You must constantly be asking questions, looking for connections, and always searching and seeking to find new meanings. And again, an acute attention to visual culture is one of the traits that I want to push in my students. And it's also a trait that I want to push in myself because, again, it's so easy just to be overwhelmed by volume. And it's so easy just to like things. As designer Frank Chimero says, remember, looking at design is not making design. But however, actively looking at images yields active making. So in order to get my students to pause and think about the images that they were constantly gathering, I created an exercise for them. I wanted them to pick five things, and only five things. Five things that are important to the way that they have worked, to the way that they have been working, the way that they aspire to work. I wanted to see images, objects, stories, experiences, and anything related to visual culture that strikes a deep chord within you, okay? And then I wanted them to tie these items together and have them help them, like have these images guide them through their next big project. Five's pretty arbitrary, but I wanted myself and my students to slow down and just pick five images, and only five, okay? And the next part of the assignment was to share those five. And so what I discovered, again, I told them that I was going to do this assignment along with them, which was like a huge mistake. I always get myself in trouble whenever I tell my students I'm going to do the assignment along with them, because I'm just like, oh, what did I do? But again, I knew that I had given them a difficult assignment because it was really hard to pick just five things. It was so hard, in fact, I decided I was going to make a talk about it because I wanted to get more mileage out of the hours I spent doing this. So anyway, looking thoughtfully and with intention is really, really hard. And then having to talk about it is even harder. But that was the point. So now I'm going to share with you my five things that I discovered along the way through this process. So this first one is an image of my grandmother with her first published children's book at the age of 23 in 1944. This image has been with me in some capacity for as long as I can remember. The second one is a love letter generated on a computer punch card from my dad to my mom in 1967. The third one is an insane eraser and ribbon collection. Again, I have no idea where I found these, but they have been with me digitally for years, living on desktops, hard drives, and various online storage archiving applications. They're kind of like the digital security blanket of collections for me. Four, Garbage Pail Kids, circa 1984. I still have a massive collection. And then number five, I wish I owned this, but this image of every building on the Sunset Strip by Ed Ruscha, 1966, has been very influential in the way that I work. So I had my things, right? But I had no idea what they meant other than I knew that they were very, very important to me. And so through the next several hours, I tried to make connections and I tried to make meaning and I tried to make connections to the way that I'm working now and to the ways that I hope to be working in the future. So I started identifying broad themes and I also started identifying other things that related to the original five things. And again, these things are just a snapshot of me in May 2014. So if you do this exercise, your things now are gonna change, you know, a couple months from now. They're certainly gonna change a couple years from now because when you change, your things change with you. So I'm gonna go into a little more detail for my things of May 2014. So my grandma. Again, this picture has always been the origin story, like part of the origin story of my grandmother, Nan Pollard. This picture pinpoints the moment she became a professional illustrator. She is 23, and this is a publicity still for her new book that she just published. My grandmother has had an immense effect on both my aesthetic as well as my work ethic and attitude. She illustrated over 1,000 children's books during her 50-year career. She joyfully loved her work was play, and her play was work. And again, I have many good memories of being in her studio, watching her work, asking her dumb questions, and secretly hoping to catch the fumes from her spray fixative, which she also had a darkroom down there, and I really liked the way the chemicals smelled down there, too. So anyway, it's like this weird kind of like nostalgic, whenever I smell students using spray fix, I think of my grandmother, which is a very bizarre association. Anyway, I'll move on. So my grandmother was very organized and very structured, and she always talked about how fortunate she was to be an illustrator. People loved working with her. She had a joyful public personality and a hilariously filthy private sense of humor. Some of her favorite swear words were o-balls or son of a bitch, said all as one word quickly under her breath. She also worked on a wide variety of projects, from paper doll books to the Planet of the Apes. She would tackle them all. She also raised four kids during the 1950s and 1960s. She was a full-time illustrator from the time she was 23 until she literally could not see well enough to draw at the age of 78. And she also had an amazing sense of fashion. She had fun with color and patterns and with unusual pairings. She wore what she liked and she didn't care about trends. And I loved her house. Her walls were jammed with family photographs and meaningful objects. And my walls are jammed as well. She was the first person to give me permission to be a maximalist. No color was too much and no pattern was too garish as long as you were having fun with it. And so I always think, what would Grandma do whenever I'm doing an installation, a window display, or working on an illustration? Like, how do I organize all of this chaos? How do I overwhelm but still inform? How can there be more color? And how can there be more things and take up more space? And how can they elicit more engagement? So she would always say, more is more. And that's how I kind of approach things too. It's very anti-graphic designer of me, which is always supposed to be less is more. I'm very more is more. So my grandmother, she passed away last year. And I was tremendously fortunate to receive her drawing table. And so she knew I would use it every single day for the rest of my life, and I plan on proving her right. And I was actually just hired to illustrate a book on fashion, so I hope to channel her for this project because, oh my God, I need some help. So anyway, here's a picture of my mom and my grandma, and I promise that the kid in the middle is me and not some creepy ventriloquist doll, which is what it kind of looks like. So this photograph of my grandmother at 23 with her first published work is one of my five things because it reminds me to work hard and never take making for granted. And it also, like, it just, again, like, before I started this exercise, this picture had just always been one that I just associated with my grandmother. I never really put together or, like, thought deeply about how my grandmother's had this type of influence on my work until I actually made myself slow down and figure it out. So anyway, the next thing I want to talk about is this punch card love letter from my dad to my mom. And this, it says my dad gave this to my mom in college. He was taking like a computer science class. This was like in 1967, and they both went to school at Iowa State, and he hated it. He was from Southern California, and he hated the winters, and he wanted to leave just desperately. And so he wrote, "Think we should quit and go to Australia, okay?" And if you knew my dad, like, that is probably the most sappy thing he's ever said in his entire life. He's like the most sarcastic, dry human being in the universe. And the fact that he did it on a computer is so fitting. Because it's just like, of course you use this huge machine to write, like, compute the data of love or something like that. But I had always had this, and I just was kind of fascinated by it. But when I slowed down to think about it, I loved it so much, not because it was a sweet thing between my mom and dad, but because I like it when boring, everyday things do unexpected things. And this is why I really like this image. This is a computer punch card that is meant to, again, just to kind of compute everyday data, and he used it to write this love letter. And so I like to picture that my dad generated this letter on this machine, which it's not. That's not my dad either. But that computer has a wheel, and I'm very curious as to where it's going. But anyway, he generated it on this machine. That's also not my dad. But again, he made something very sterile into something very human. And again, punch cards are beautiful. This also kind of goes into my obsession about how I love office supplies, and I love design that looks like it wasn't designed by a designer. I vernacular type, all of that stuff where it's just part of the everyday, and I find it tremendously beautiful. And again, I have other mundane, elevating images that I want to share with you too. This is David Byrne in his iconic white suit. And I freaking love David Byrne, and it's because he takes elevating the mundane very seriously as well. For example, he took a boring business suit and took it to the logical extreme. And then another one of my favorite kind of mundane elevating pieces of pop culture is the David Byrne movie True Stories. It's one of my favorite movies, and if you haven't seen it, please do, because this movie is all about elevating the mundane and celebrating the specialness of boringness. And plus, a baby John Goodman is in this movie, and he is adorable, so adorable. So anyway, and it's also responsible for one of my favorite movie stills of all time. It just says, "Shopping is a feeling." Another one of my favorite people who does a really good job with boring things is the photographer Martin Parr, who happens to collect boring postcards. Faden published 2 volumes of his collections a few years ago, and Parr stated that for a postcard to qualify as sufficiently boring, either its composition or its content or the characters featured must be arguably boring, or the photograph must be absent of anything which might conventionally be described as interesting. But together as a group, they are totally fascinating. As a group, they are elevated to this extreme interesting state for me. And he has 2 volumes of these postcards if anyone is interested. This artist, Peter Valdez, he photographed the movement of his cell phone after 10 missed calls, and then he stitched a rainbow infographic tracking these missed conversations. This is so beautiful and sad and boring and amazing. I wanna know who was calling him, why he wouldn't pick up the phone, why he would spend so much time stitching this beautiful rainbow movement of just like sadness and loneliness as it just glided across his glass top coffee table. It's wonderful. And so again, like I found myself being drawn to all of these just kind of, oh, it's kind of boring, but it's really interesting. And there are a lot of boring aspects to the work that I do too. For example, in 2004, when I found myself $24,000 in credit card debt, I wasn't like I just found myself in credit card debt. It wasn't like I woke up one morning and was like, oh, damn, how did that happen? No, I mean, I was very aware of the road I was taking. So I decided one day that I was going to draw all of my credit card statements until they were paid off, basically, okay? These machine-generated credit card statements carried mountains of anxiety and stress. And so at that point, the only kind of control I felt, other than paying them off like a good human, was to also kind of pick a way of working at that point that I hated, which was drawing. I absolutely hated drawing. And then, like a kid who got in trouble talking in class, you know, I wrote all of my credit card statements every single month, and then I made myself accountable, and I put them online, and I shared them with people, basically saying, listen, I was completely terrified to tell anybody that I was almost $25,000 in credit card debt, and now, in order for me to actually get a handle of this, I'm telling people I know, strangers I don't know, like, I'm very motivated by, I don't want to let people down. So even if those people don't even care if I complete this project, just knowing that it's out there in the ether, like that I made this promise that I was going to do it, I will do it. Because if I just told myself and didn't share it, I wouldn't care if I let myself down, honestly. I mean, that's kind of how my mind works a little bit. But again, it was just, this project lasted for 6 years. And I drew hundreds of credit card statements. And on the way, I also became this unexpected debt counseling service for strangers and my students, too. And so I would get these emails from people, and they're really, I mean, they're very serious emails, just telling me how much money they owed and how they couldn't tell anybody about it and just, like, looking for help. And I would, like, email them back. And then my office hours would actually turn into debt counseling office hours because I would have a student show up in my doorway and I would think that they would need help for scheduling the next term. And I'm like, oh yeah, come in, Susie, come in. And she's like, can I close the door? I'm like, okay. And then she'd sit down and be like, are you supposed to pay your credit cards off every single month? And I'm like, oh honey, let's sit down and talk. And so it kind of consumed many years of my life, and also it made me also realize how poor of a job we do with credit card education too, just from the experiences I had with my students and how little they actually knew about how to handle their money, basically. And I think it's a big problem, and that's a whole other talk that I'm not going to get into, but I definitely think that everyone needs to, we could be doing better, basically. So again, this project wasn't exactly a blast, okay, but that wasn't the point. But one of the things that emerged from this project is that I began to really enjoy drawing forms and bits of paper. And so I started drawing my receipts. And then I recently actually acquired an oversized thermal printer, which is, all of our receipts are printed on small thermal printers. And I got a huge thermal printer. And so now I'm like, I want my receipts to be printed as big as possible. So that's kind of what I'm doing right now. And again, I love drawing the bits and pieces of paper that we end up throwing away. These bits and pieces of paper that symbolize money that we once had, basically, and experiences that aren't really that tangible too, like a bus ride. The only experience you have from a bus ride, you know, left over is the ticket, or maybe you ended up smelling like BO because you sat next to somebody and it was really smelly. But anyway, it's like these little bits and pieces of paper that are these symbols of the experience. And so this led me to my daily drawing project, which was an 8-year-long daily purchase drawing project. And again, I drew everyday objects. And these are not objects that were particularly interesting, but objects that we all have relationships with. So this everyday fascination with the everyday, really, it kind of also leads me to my next thing, my number three thing, which are my erasers and my ribbons. They're so beautiful. Aren't they great? Look at, they're just, it's like, I like to imagine that eraser collection belongs to like the coolest third grader in the universe. Seriously, I absolutely love both of these images. I sometimes when I'm stressed out, I just kind of look at them and they calm me down. I'm like, oh, it's so nice, so good. But what I realized is how much I love collections and making things in multiples, okay? So again, like look at these guys, they're just gorgeous. And this also pays into my maximalist tendencies. I'm always drawn to visually obnoxious imagery, always, okay? These photographs by Jiang Mi-yoon, they absolutely slay me. Again, the intensity of the multiples and the collections and the concept behind them are extremely powerful. And Andreas Gursky has always made me want to give everyone in this room a high five. It's just, he's just, like, absolutely, I just want to, like, dive into his photographs. Again, the intensity of the multiples, the collections of the people and the color. And I love looking at all sorts of collections and hearing stories behind them. So I want to hear about your record collection, your security envelope collection, your mixtape collection, your freaking succulent collection, your damn condiment collection. That is somebody's condiment collection. Somebody collects all sorts of condiments. That's like what they do. I was just actually heard on NPR when I was coming over here today that there are people that are obsessed with collecting pennies now because pennies aren't worth anything. And there's this huge community online of people that just collect an amazing amount of pennies and hope that they find the pennies that were made before 1982 that are made out of copper. It's like a gambling thing because copper pennies are worth 2 cents. Okay? And so it was just like this amazing obsession that I love anybody that has kind of amazing obsessions, and I think that's what collections really, what they really are too. Also, this person has a fan collection. I want to hear about your collections. And again, my obsession with collections and multiples is why I think I keep creating collections of my own. Again, whether it's these daily purchase drawings, which I stopped this project on February 5th, 2008, and I had over 2,900 drawings, okay, of just everyday objects of things that I purchased. I'm also collecting and drawing other people's mixtapes. Again, talk about objects that we imprint emotion on, these machine-made objects where, you know, it's again, like I have people that send me images of their mixtapes and tell me there's big, long stories about how this was a breakup tape or how this was a makeup tape or how this was just, it's just, they're totally fascinating. And then also collecting stories and drawing objects about things that people have stolen. That's what those little slips of paper are that I pass out whenever I go to give talks. I have people telling me about the things that they've stolen, and I've been drawing different objects that you've stolen and collecting your stolen item stories. And I'm also collecting passwords from people too. And passwords are interesting in that everybody has passwords. We're all using passwords to protect our things online, basically. But like, how are we choosing passwords? And I've discovered that everyone's really kind of filthy whenever they're choosing their passwords. So basically, I can't stop collecting things to draw. And whenever I'm taking pictures, I'm always drawn to multiples. So this is, you know, multiple carts, multiple Target shoppers, multiple yard sales. And kind of side note, this is also where I met my husband 10 years ago. It was when I was documenting yard sales in Lincoln, Nebraska. He threw a particularly wonderful yard sale, and I was like, who is this man? Because I'm going to marry him. And I did. So, anyway. and I also document thrift stores. And again, I'm always inserting structure and the desire for collection within my work. More kind of thrift store photos. And I also have a deep fascination with dead retail and the marks that our consumption leave behind. And these photo explorations, they led me to my very first big project where I documented all of my purchases for 28 months and shared these results on the project website, which was called Obsessive Consumption. This project now is over 12 years old. And I collected everything that I had purchased over 28 months in photographs and filed them away in tiny little glassine envelopes, and they were then all uploaded to this pre-blog era website for everyone to see. And this website kind of turned into not just a archive for my dumb things, but people would write essays about their favorite objects and their favorite experiences with objects, and I would get emails of just like shopping lists from people, and just I had a whole publication that I put together that was just filled with things that people had bought. It was just straight up text for, you know, 100 pages, and then I made it into a book and sold that because I like these circles and this whole kind of like consumption collapsing on each other. Anyway, right now I'm collecting yard sale signs in preparation for drawing them. I do wait until the yard sale is over before I tear the sign down, even though it is really tempting sometimes when there's an especially good yard sale sign. I do want to rip it down, but I'm a good person and I wait till the damn sale is over with before I rip it down. But again, Portland really likes to play up its yard sales. Rad yard sale, awesome yard sale. But it's really mostly, again, baby clothes and broken appliances. But still, the signs are excellent, okay? They're truly excellent. And also, free boxes, they're everywhere in Portland. And so I have a pretty extensive photo collection of just what people decide that they can't quite put into the dumpster, and they think that they still might have some life for other people. I've been drawing those objects too. But let me tell you what, like this 1 gallon of mayonnaise that was only like a little bit full, that could have gone into the trash, okay? And there's no reason that needed to go on the curb at all. And then when I was, this orange pipe cleaner, that was in a box by itself, just an orange pipe cleaner by itself. And I was out with my dog and I saw that and I was like, oh, that person's just too lazy to put it in the trash. And I like walked around the block and I came back and the orange pipe cleaner was gone. So what do I know? You know, it's great. It's this whole kind of like commerce we're creating here. And I've also been collecting handmade thrift store ceramics. These clunky and awesome artifacts of giving and making are now being memorialized through some clunky line drawings and watercolors. And again, there's nothing sadder than a handmade gift that ends up in a thrift store. And like the inscription, like, to my aunt, and it's like Goodwill, you know, it's just, I'm like, oh, that's so sad. But there's so many of them, and I think especially now, especially when we're like at the, like everyone making things for everyone has been very popular, wonderfully popular for the last several years, but the thrift stores are getting filled with all of our handmade items, which is, you know, they gotta go somewhere, I guess. And again, that another, my last collection that I've been working on is that I've been drawing other people's house plants too, because I think we all have a really interesting relationship with our plants. This little kind of unspoken relationship with their plants that I'm trying to dive into a little bit deeper. A lot of the stories have been revealing some pretty nostalgic collections to these house plants, and that's been a pretty fun project that I've been working on just recently. So yeah, I guess like I cherish my erasers and my ribbons, and I love my collections and my multiples, and my obsession with collections is incredibly important and visible in my work. And again, I just hadn't really thought about that as the reason as to why I was so obsessed with these two original images, which are these erasers and ribbons. So My number four are Garbage Pail Kids, which I'm sure you all are pretty familiar with. This number four is a collection that took me down the road of what I like to call creepy cute. Okay? So the creepy cute aesthetic is one of my most favorite aesthetics. It's adorable and kind of vomit-inducing all at the same time. It's where you combine glitter and zits, and then you get, woo, creepy cute, right? Okay, so this is creepy cute. This is creepy cute. This is creepy cute. This is creepy cute. I don't know what she's holding, but it's kind of cute, but it's also kind of creepy, okay? This is creepy cute. That's creepy cute. That's most certainly creepy cute. Pee Wee Herman's creepy cute. And also, like, early days of Pee Wee Herman, his midnight show had a zine, which I think is fantastic. And my nerd loins exploded because up in the top right-hand corner, there's a picture of Pee Wee Herman with Steve Martin. Total love. Anyway, and that's creepy cute. Jambi is totally creepy cute. So I do a lot of work in textiles, and I appropriate a lot of stereotypical, like, cute ways of making. And again, like, these days, a lot of craft equals cute, which is absolutely fine. But I want my craft to equal creepy cute. So this pillow right here is a representation of my guts digesting my credit card annual percentage rates. Okay? And it is, like, that's like, oh God, 18.9 APR, I'm gonna puke. And so that's, I don't hold like a whole pillow series based on that. And then when I draw people, I intentionally draw them in a creepy cute way. So that's a creepy cute J.R. Ewing. And this is a creepy cute Nicki Minaj and a creepy cute Zooey Deschanel. And I also adore drawing creepy cute presidents. So, and recently I bought a creepy cute book on cats and made a creepy cute drawing. And then a few weeks later, I bought a book on Joseph Beuys and drew a creepy cute Joseph Beuys book. And then for maximum creepy cuteness, I combined the two and made a creepy cute kitty and Joseph Beuys pattern. So this is actually truly where my interest lies right now, is just trying to figure out how to do more creepy cute things. So my very last image that I'm going to share with you is Every Building on the Sunset Strip by Ed Ruscha. I saw a copy of this book when I was in high school and was fascinated by the content and structure. Again, Ed Ruscha is also known as, he's a photographer, and he's also an artist who makes these text-based paintings and prints. But again, I know him and love him as the guy who introduced me to what I like to call automated projects. And automated projects, they have a set of rules to follow. And these rules help aid creation. These rules help people keep moving and making. And so in the early 1960s, Ed Ruscha had several photo projects going on at once. 34 parking lots, some LA apartments, and 26 gasoline stations, to name a few. And for these book projects, he developed a series of rules. And in an Art News interview in 1982, Ruscha said, "It became rules that I knew I had to follow. Then it was just a matter of being a good little art soldier and finishing it." And after reading these words, it clicked with me. I need rules to help me make work, okay? I love working with rule systems and automated directives. Again, they keep me moving and they keep me making. Almost every single project that I have ever done has some sort of rule structure to help guide the creation and content. Again, rules and constraints are good because constraint yields creation. I think the kiss of death is whenever somebody tells you that you can just do whatever you want to do. Like, oh, here, whatever you want to do. I think one of the most terrifying things is getting a new sketchbook and trying to, like, figure out what you're going to put on that first page. It's just this, like, you open up that blank sketchbook and it's like it's laughing at you, basically. And so in order to kind of combat those, that kind of like that paralyzing feeling, is that's when I started doing rule structures. And that absolutely, like, creating a system of rules for myself, absolutely, it helps me with creation. And then also, along with Ruscha's rule structure, I also love his affinity for printed matter, and accessible printed matter too. So all of my daily drawings are published in monthly zines. And again, making zines has led to an excellent relationship with my current publisher, Princeton Architectural Press, who has published three of my books so far, with the most recent being released just a few years ago. Wait, not a few years ago, a few months ago. So I've got three books from them. And again, like, I know that if I hadn't made zines, that these books wouldn't even exist. And again, I just love the tangibility and accessibility of zines. And I love collecting people's zines. I know, surprise. And I also frequently conduct zine workshops, and I travel around, give lectures about zines, history of zines, and I absolutely love sharing my collections with others, too. It's really, zines are just they're just the best. And again, zine making and trading is absolutely addictive. So those are my five things. Thank you for listening to my five things. But some of the things that I kind of, like, learned through this process is that it's important to remind myself to not be a passive looker. I think it's so easy just to become numb to all these images that we see all the time and be like, oh yeah, whatever, big deal. Oh, totally not impressed by that. Oh, whatever, whatever. Like, stop it. Stop it with being so passive. Because we see great images every single day. Every single day. And it's so easy to get numb to this. And I always want to remind myself to be thoughtfully looking and then thoughtfully making, okay? Because what happens when we start consuming images passively is we start really kind of making dumb mistakes too. Like, we start making uninteresting work, or we accidentally copy somebody because we didn't really pay attention to where we first saw that image and we like kind of digested it and regurgitated it because we weren't thinking about it. We just add to that pile of repetitive imagery that already exists. And again, like, you know, don't get me wrong, I love collecting images. I've got crazy Pinterest boards, okay? I love collecting images, but just for, you know, a break, just for an experiment, ask yourself what your five things are too, okay? It's really a fun process, it completely is. And if you do ask yourself, like, go through this process, you should share it with each other too, okay? Because I think the sharing is where kind of the magic happens again. Because, like, when I have my students do this assignment, it could be a classroom of students that don't really know each other that well. And then they come in with their five things, and they have to share those five things, and they see a lot of overlapping, a lot of commonalities. Conversations happen, okay? And it's such a simple, simple thing to do. So my call to action to you guys is for you to think about what your five things are, and that's it. I'm done. Thank you very much. Do you guys have any questions at all?
I was just curious what your favorite drawing tools are, like, do you use pen and nib or certain pens?
Oh, I love talking about pens. I'm so serious. Like, I had a student in my office the other day who really wanted feedback on his portfolio, but he had a whole bag of pens. And I ended up talking about pens for 15 minutes, and I was like, I'm so sorry that I just, like, kind of wasted your time. But, like, if you're a pen nerd, that's okay. He was totally good with it. But my favorite pens are Faber-Castell pens. Those are my favorite. Like, just I use the brush pens, and I use the super fine points, and I go through boxes and boxes and boxes of Faber-Castell pens. Just get them in bulk. Go to blick.com. Order them by the box, because if you buy them one by one, they're going to be $4 a piece, but you can get them online for like $1.30 in bulk. That's I've got lots of them. Yeah.
Did you get to work hands-on with Jed after that?
No, but we did tweet to each other back and forth. Does that count? I wish. That would have been amazing. No, I just ended up staring. So the Chipotle campaign is basically, the backs of your bags and cups now have 2-minute stories that have been written by a variety of comedians and authors. And then the gussets of the bags are the illustrations of those stories. And so, and it's actually, I mean, I know Chipotle, it's burritos, whatever, but it's actually kind of a really, it's kind of a great campaign in that those bags could have been advertising stuff. They could have been coupons for something, but instead it's a bunch of really wonderful stories written by these very smart people that when you go to Chipotle by yourself, you don't have to look at your phone, you can look at the bag. But it was a really fun experience. But yeah, just tweeting, and only twice. So any other questions? Yes.
I've wondered on your daily drawings, like, you actually, those are things that you actually purchase mm-hmm. every day, right?
Yeah, those are all my things. Those are all my things. And people have asked too, they're like, did you really buy something every single day? And, you know, whether it was active consumption or passive consumption, yeah. And I classify passive consumption as we're always paying for our rent. We're always paying for our electricity. We're always paying for our, like, those monthly bills where we're just slowly being bled dry. And so, you know, even though there's like one day you're like, I didn't buy anything today, you're like, oh, but then there's all those monthly things that are kind of, you know, yeah, you're just always draining money. That was a really bummer way to answer that question. Really bummer. Yeah.
Do you think doing that project has changed, like, how you spend and what you think about?
Absolutely. I mean, that project, for how that started, as I read someplace that creation comes from frustration, and that project came from me being frustrated with drawing my credit card statements, and so that frustration yielded this way of doing daily drawings, and it did, like the credit card project was it worked in a different way, and that, you know, it was just the repetition, and it was kind of the discipline, and it was just like this overwhelming desire to pay off my bills faster so I wouldn't have to draw 6 credit card statements every single month, that type of thing. That worked in one way, but then the daily drawings, it added a little bit of levity to the project in a way, because when people viewed the credit card statements, they walked away thinking about their own debt too, which I thought was, you know, was good, and they walked away thinking about, you know, how much they owed, how deep in debt they were, or if they weren't in debt, other people that were in debt too. But then the daily drawing project, it was different. It was more of a shared experience. Like, I would post a drawing of, you know, a movie that I went to, and someone would be like, "Oh, I went to that movie. I remember that movie. That was really great." And so, like, these kind of like these small little mini conversations would come from my daily drawings of just the shared experience that we all have in this bizarre world of consumption that we live in. And so a lot of those shared experiences aren't negative, they're actually positive. They yield relationships, they yield, you know, friendships, they yield different stories, and it's all based around like this object that we have in common. And so that's what I liked from the Daily Drawing Project. It did make me become still an active participant in my own consumption, but I liked how it also created conversations, and it created stories, and it also, other people started drawing their daily purchases too, which I thought was really fun. It got people excited about starting one-a-day projects too, and there's a lot of people that are doing one-a-day projects, and I'm not saying I started one-a-day projects, but it's like, I feel like because of the internet, that whole, like, you know, doing things in that automated project corner structure, like when we share those things, it's like you've almost become like this community of people that are making things every single day. And I don't know, I think good things come from being productive and making and sharing every day, even if what you make every day isn't that great, okay? If you just keep making, it's gonna get better. The worst thing you could do is to not make any work at all, basically. So I don't know, the things that I miss the most about not doing the daily drawing project isn't the tracking of the consumption, it's the fact that I had that, you know, hour a day where I would sit down and I would just, it was like, almost became like this really just chilled out, quiet time where it was just me and the pen. And I'm still like, I still do other drawings, but I like that. I mean, I'm still making lots of work, but it was just simply for me. And it was the fact that I'm like, I've got to do this every day. And I've noticed that I get really cranky if I don't make something every single day. So I do, I miss that. Yeah.
You said before your credit card statement project, yeah, you didn't like, you hated
it. No,
drawing.
I hated it.
I think you said you hated drawing.
I did, I hated it.
What was your artistic outlet?
Well, I was way into photography and installation. I took a lot, it was a lot of photo documentation projects. I did a lot of like early internet web projects sort of things. I was always, you know, doing design work and just, you know, exhibiting photographs and doing installation work. But the drawing part, like, I was the kid in drawing one class that would like leave early, that would like fake a sketchbook, basically, like your sketchbook requirements, be like, "Oh, I'm just gonna do this really quick. This is gonna look like I did this for the last 3 weeks." No, nobody, no, you're not fooling anyone when you do that. And then I just felt completely uncomfortable with drawing, which is ridiculous because I grew up around drawing. But still in my brain, I felt like you had to draw one certain way and that's what equaled like good. And I'm thinking, my God, like my parents were weavers, my grandparents were artists and illustrators, and if I exit a family like that, thinking that one way of drawing equals good, like, that's crazy. That is crazy. And so I just really didn't have an enjoyment at all But I was always kind of good at lettering, though. I was really good at forging parents' signatures when I was in school. I was always the go-to person for like really good bubble letter. So, but yeah. So by picking drawing and doing something every day, you actually end up kind of liking it, and you end up feeling confident in what you're doing too. So yeah.
For your freelance work, do you represent yourself or do you have an agent?
I represent myself, and I feel like I've been pretty lucky, because like when I started the Daily Drawing Project, it wasn't like, no, I'm going to start an illustration career. I was just like, this is just part of my documentation projects that I've done for the last several years, and I just started putting them up online, and then that's when different art directors and magazine art directors would contact me wanting me to start doing work, and so I'm like, oh, okay, I'll try this. This is really strange. I just recently got representation in Europe, because that's just a little bit more hard for me to handle, because it's time change freaks me out. But I have an agent in Amsterdam right now, so. But yeah, but I'm free agent here. So. Yeah.
I'm curious, like long-term journaling projects are really interesting. I'm curious if there were like surprises or like emergent patterns or things that surprised you after doing something like recording your receipts or your purchases.
I think it's one of the reasons I stopped is that after about 5 years into the project, my style just kind of stopped. Like you can see like drawings from 2006, 2007, 2008, early 2009. Like it was like evolving, 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 evolving. And then 2010, I was like, that's my line. And that's what I'm doing. And that's what I do for all my freelance stuff too. And it was just kind of like, where is this going? And I had thought when I first started this project, and I was several years into it, because it really just took up a tiny amount of time in my life. I'm like, I can do this forever. I'm gonna do this forever, guys. Like I would tell, I'm doing this project, and just it's gonna be like years and years and years. But and I found like just the fact that I was just like, I feel like I really need to. I think stopping it actually was the surprise for me, because it really didn't take up that much time. But I felt like it took up a lot of mental energy a little bit, and also I was getting frustrated with myself because I didn't want to get placed into this spot of like, oh, she's the girl who draws her stuff, you know, and so, which is cool. I love that being the girl who draws her stuff is like, it's why I'm here talking to you. It's why I'm like putting out books. Like, it's great. But it's actually Josh Berger who told me this. He's like this amazing like design Buddha for me, basically. He was like, Kate, in order to begin things, you've got to quit things. And I was like, oh, you're right. And so I was like, yeah, I'm gonna quit this so I can begin something else. And that feeling's been kind of great. So I think that was what was surprising to me. And also the fact that I break my iPhone all the time and I've drawn a lot of iPhones. So anyway, yeah.
Course in the time period of all the things that were collected.
Yeah.
What was the one thing that just to this day has like irked you and wrote you out to remember?
Of what being collected? Of like what me?
Of other people's stuff.
Oh, of other like stuff that that jar of mayonnaise is pretty gross. The stuff, it's funny, like, especially with the stolen items that people, is that what you're asking about? Like, of what? A lot of the things that I've gathered from people, and again, the stolen, the shoplifting project is a complex project, in that when I first started doing this project, I thought it was going to be, that would just be kind of like jokey stuff, you know, just kids being stupid, stealing things, but, people steal things because they need things to survive. And people steal things because they are in a desperate situation and they don't know what else to do. And so the people talking to me about when times they've had to like steal food or they've had to steal baby formula, you know? It's this consumption is complex. And so it's just why I feel like the Daily Drawing Project's done with, but the topic of still exploring our wants and needs and our wants and desires and what we do with our objects, like that topic just keeps, it's just so many levels and layers of things to talk about and to draw about, but I do have a hard time thinking that I'm just always gonna kind of like explore that for sure. So I think it's more like, what surprised me the most was a lot of sadness that came from that, so. And then the jar of mayonnaise, it's gross. It was gross. Okay, anything else? All good? Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much.
Very much. Yeah.